favorite service. First service gave Dustin and I cookies. We didn't get anything from you guys, so I don't know. It's leaning pretty good that way. All joking aside, it's good to have you guys here this morning. We start a new series this morning. We also start into our two services this morning, as you well know, and so we're excited about that. On your way in, if you grabbed a connection card in a program, please take that connection card out now. We ask everybody to fill one of these out, whether you've been here 1,000 times or this is your first time. If you call YGBC your home, we just need your name on there. And if you're new, you've never filled one of those out before, we ask that you just put as much on that card as you feel comfortable filling out, because we don't give that information to anybody. We don't spam you with any of that. That's just for in-house purposes. And then after the service is over, everybody can put those cards in the box labeled connection cards on the table there in the back next to the tithes and offerings box. If you're watching online with us today, you can go ahead and scan the QR code that's on your screen now, and that will take you to our online connection card. For those of you who are here in the building as well, if you're ever not here with us, you're on vacation, but you're watching online, we stream this on YouTube at 10:30, and you want to let us know that you're here as well, you can fill out the online connection card. Looks very similar to the one that you get here in person, to let us know any information that you need, as well as keeping connected with us throughout the week as well. Now, I want to fill you in a little bit on some things over the past 2 weeks. So we weren't here in the building last week. We were out serving and embracing York, which was very cool. And also the week before that, we sent a group down to Columbus to do a mini missions trip where we got to experience Islam and Hinduism and learn about those things. Now, if you have never known anybody, you don't have any friends that are Muslim or that practice Hinduism, it was very, very interesting for our group to go down and to learn and experience those things. We got to go as a group. There was a good number of us, so we got to split up and go different places and trade back and forth. The first place that we got to go to was a Somali mosque, where we got to learn from the imam, who was the leader of the Muslim mosque there, and ask questions of him, and he would ask questions of us. And the main thing that we gained from the Muslim cultures were that, A, they are very, very committed and dedicated. It was very challenging to me to see how much and how faithful they were to their belief system, praying 5 times a day, fasting, doing all of those things, a little misguided in the direction of what they are doing that for, but they are so committed and so dedicated. And that was challenging to me. How often do I pray? How often am I committed to what we're doing here as a church and the faith that I have in Christ? And the main difference between what they believe and what we believe, they believe you can work your way into heaven. We asked the imam, who was the head honcho there, are you going to make it into heaven? And he said, I hope so. And that was so discouraging to me, man. As believers in Jesus Christ, we know with absolute certainty we're going to spend eternity in heaven with him. There's no I hope so about it. And so that was kind of discouraging, but also encouraging in the way we know where we're going after we die. Now, a couple of our ladies here got to dress the part while we were there. They asked us to do this, so that was kind of fun for them to experience that culture there as well. We also got to go to a Hindu temple, which if you've never done that before, that was an interesting experience. And it was very cool to hear the different things that they do and why they do it and learn about those different things. Also, after we got to visit those places, we got to eat ethnic food. So we go to a Somali mosque and then we go have some Somalian food. We go to the Buddhist, the Hindu temple, and we go out and have some Indian food afterwards. So it was a really cool experience for us as a group just to see the different cultures, see how God loves these people and wants to reach these people as well, but encourage us in our faith to live out what it means to follow Jesus and to reach people that maybe we aren't familiar with their cultures and what they believe and why they do what they do. So that was very cool. Hopefully you can join us next year for Encounter Columbus. Also, last week, how many of you participated in Embrace York Day? Right? We had a very vast majority of our church participate in that. For those of you who don't know what that is, we spend a week during the summer and we aren't here in the building. We go out and we serve Embrace York. We serve the community. We do things for our in-house people who aren't able to come and visit with us. We make bags and things for them. We go out, we pull weeds, we go to different places. So what better way for us to celebrate what we did than with a highlight video? So I'm going to show you the highlight video. The band is going to come up and lead us in song in that way, and then we'll be right back with you. So check out this video.
Thank you. Morning, everyone. This is Judy here. Just wanted to give a shout out to the great group that we had on Embrace York Day. We were able to make like 15 bags for those within our church family and a few that we have connections with. In other ways, we were able to do a lot of creativity with paper and glue and stickers and washi tape. So everyone came up with some really cool things, and we had a great time. One of the awesome things for us was that this year Barb and Howard Langenstein were able to be part of the group as opposed to being on the list and being housebound. So that was exciting for all of us, and just being able to encourage and make contact with those that aren't able to get to church all the time.
Good morning, Thrive Church. Our project for Embrace York was to do weeding and lawn care up at Ferguson Elementary. We had a team of about 25 people, maybe four families and some individuals, and we worked very hard. Lots of weeds, lots of edging to do, and weed whacking around the building, around the fences. It was an excellent team effort, and we did well. The best part of the whole project, after we were done working, we went to take a group picture in front of the Ferguson sign at the entrance, and we stopped and we prayed for the kids. We prayed for York County, we prayed for York City, we were praying for Mrs. Mathis, the school principal, and her job there. And when we were done praying, we looked up, and there she was standing. So I thought, for her, there was probably nothing better in the world than to come touch base with us and walk up to us while we were all standing there praying for her and her kids. So it was a great day, and we had just a huge opportunity to bless all those at Ferguson Elementary.
Hey friends, I'm here in my own garden to report on the York Fresh Foods Farm. We had a great crew of volunteers to help out at the farm this year. This time of year, the harvest comes in fast and heavy, and so do the weeds. We cleared weeds from the several rows to get them ready for fall planting. I think the biggest impact we had was boosting the morale of the farm staff and volunteers. Having nice, clear rows free of weeds to plant the next crop would be such a blessing. I'll take volunteers at my garden right now. Thank you. Pulling weeds isn't glamorous, but we had fun and good fellowship, and all the kids had a blast, helping some, but mostly just playing all morning together.
I was the leader for the train track cleanup crew. It was impactful to the community because year after year, we go down and clean up the train tracks. It's getting to the point that we can see where we left off from the year before. So it's always nice to go a little further, knowing that, you know, if we keep doing this, we keep going back each year, it's going to get cleaner and cleaner.
Good morning, church. It's good to be with you. Last week during Embrace York was actually the first week that my family was able to rejoin our church after the birth of our daughter. We were able to go out with some of the teams, and that was great. But this morning's the first one that I am able to be here physically in a little while. So thank you for all of the well wishes, all the prayers for our family as we welcomed our daughter, Eden. She is doing well, and so is mom. Eden had a checkup 2 days ago, and she has grown 3 inches since she was born, which is a lot. So that has put her in the 96th percentile for length at this point. So we're very excited to have her as a part of our family. Thank you. It's good to be here this morning, and I'm going to invite you to stand with us as we kind of tune our hearts to encounter the God that we know is here among us. We're going to sing a song thinking about how God is the God of creation and being creative, and I'll tell you what, I'm ready for there to not be so much rain. I don't know about any of you, but that's because it's getting into my basement a little bit. But I know that for some of us, we have crops, we have gardens, and the rain is such a blessing. So as we begin our morning, let's sing to God.
I've scaled all the highest of mountains. I've stood at the edge of their peaks, but I still couldn't see to the edge of your love for me. I've walked on the wildest of waters. I've sunk to the depths of the sea. And I still couldn't fathom the depths of your love for me. And canyons wide and oceans deep, they can't contain all your love for me. No matter how high or far I reach, there's no end to your love for me. I've wrestled beneath in the valley. I barely hung on through the night. But just when I thought it was darkest, the sun began to rise.
Amen.
See it out. And canyons wide and oceans deep, they can't contain. After me, how could I fall when you already took the fall for me? Beyond the stars, the very breath I breathe, there's no end to your love for me. Where could I run that you wouldn't run after me? And how could I fall? You already took the fall for me. Beyond the stars, to the very breath I breathe, there's no end to your love for me. Canyons wide and oceans deep, they can't contain all your love for me. No matter how high or far I
I want to read a little bit of scripture to us because I think it'll help us as we focus in this morning. In Psalm 63, it says this: because your love is better than life, my lips will glorify you. I will praise you as long as I live, and in your name I will lift my hands. I'll be fully satisfied as with the richest of foods. With singing lips, my mouth will praise you. On my bed, I remember you. I think of you through the watches of the night. Because you are my help, I sing in the shadow of your wings. I cling to you. Your right hand upholds me. And I want to encourage us to think about those last two statements. Because on the one hand, because you are my help, I sing in the shadow of your wings. Some of us are here this morning because we look back and we see what God has done over and over and over and over again in our lives. And it fills us up with this joy and this confidence, and we just want to sing. We want to make his praises great. Others of us are here to cling to him. Because right now, what's going on in our lives outside of this building, we don't know what's going to happen. And we just need to show up and say, God, I don't get it. I don't know what's going on right now. I don't know what you're doing right now, but I just need to be with you. I need to cling to you because all I know is it's your hand that upholds me. And that's this beauty of what God invites us into, is that both of those things can happen at the exact same time. We gain courage from looking into the past, and we cling to him with hope for the present and the future. So as we sing this next song, whichever your story is coming in, whether you're clinging this morning, whether you're singing this morning, I invite you to just meet with God as we sing this next song.
I search the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough. You came along, put me back together. And every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing that's better than you. There's nothing that's better than
bones into army.
offer this heart, oh God, completely.
Let's lift our voices high as we sing.
So I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in awe of the one who gave it all. I'll stand my soul, Lord, to you surrendered all. I am is yours.
Lift you up. And as we are in your presence, as we've been singing, as we have gathered, and as we've acknowledged that we have all of these stories coming together, some good, some bad, some confidence, some concern, and some worry, and it all meets, God, I ask that as we open up your word, that you would do what only you can do and speak through your word. Speak through Pastor Dustin so that we might come away with what you would have each one of us to learn this morning about our own lives, our own situations uniquely, but then as a church, that we would know how to walk in such a way to represent you well at a time when that's hard and it's confusing. So we ask all this in your Son Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, you can be seated. Thank you so much.
Well, good morning and welcome, church. We're so excited. We got second service in the building. We got our online watching right now. So I just want to say welcome and thank you for coming. Thank you for being a part of this. And just real quick, we're venturing into two services and we're doing it with a purpose. So I just want to make sure we all understand the purpose of what we're doing when we come to two services. We were growing, we're filling up. You know, our parking lot, we can have a whole lot of cars out there. We're never going to run out of parking space. Upstairs, we were starting to fill up. We were starting to see more and more people come and engage. And downstairs is where we really had a pinching point where we had a lot of kids and Grace kids and we couldn't stretch the basement any bigger. It'd be nice if we could just like hook it up to a truck and just stretch another 20 foot out of our basement. But we can't. And so the Grace kids area was filling up. And so moving to two services is one that lets us spread out. And right now is a time we want to have some space and the ability to spread out. If that helps people be able to join us here, that's something that's good. And downstairs, we aren't packing our classes as full and teachers don't have 20 preschoolers running around with markers and glitter and glue and all those things that make me twitch just thinking about. So downstairs, the kids workers are having a great time. Our Grace Kids ministry team is doing an incredible job loving on your kids and having fun. It positions us with two services to be able to grow, to be able to balance two services. So first service, we were a little bit heavier attended. There's probably about 20 more people upstairs in first service. And so second service, thank you guys for coming. It's great to see everybody here. And we would love to balance the services out. We have about the same number of people coming to both service. And then we have room to grow. And to grow, we gather. And a gatherer says, what? Come with me. All right, a little bit louder. Here, we got to do it louder. What does a gatherer say? Come with me. Come with me. And I even love hearing stories about our online people that are watching and joining us online. They're gathering people to watch the service with them online. And so gathering can happen in the building. Gathering can happen online. We have people watching from different states that are connected to people in our church that said, hey, you got to watch our church. And so God's growing us in many different directions, and we're excited about that. But we want to gather, and our dream would be in 6 months, we would love to tell a story where God took one service of people, split into two, and grew it to 100 people at each service. 40 kids downstairs, 60 adults upstairs. We would love to be able to tell that story that God is growing his church. God is doing a work here. And in that, more people are coming. More people are jumping in and being a part of what we do. So that's our vision, and that's just what I wanted to put in front of you that way. So we know as we go in and we start talking, you know, down the road, BJ talked about chocolate chip cookies and stuff like that, right? But down the road, we'll be able to hopefully be able to say, hey, we need 5 people to balance a service or 10 people to balance a service. You guys will understand that and say, hey, we can flex and we can be able to be a part of that. So Glenn is back there with Bibles. If you didn't bring a Bible with you and you would like a Bible, just raise your hand and we'll put a Bible in your hand and we can turn to the book of Acts. We're going to be in the New Testament. Testament book of Acts. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are the four Gospels. The book of Acts is what comes after that, the history of the church. So anybody need a Bible? Anybody? We're good? All right. We're in a new service, or new service, right, new series. We're in a new series, and the series is called One Another. And we're going to be taking a look at what the Bible says about the church and how the church is called to be the church, how the church is called to be united, how the church is called to serve each other, how the church is called to love each other, to pray for each other, to encourage each other, to give towards each other. There's a lot of one another commands all throughout the Bible, and this series is how we're going to be examining what does it look like for the church to fulfill and to follow through with what God has called the church to do. Will you pray with me? Father God, as we open your word this morning and as we begin to examine what it is you call the church to do, I would pray that you would show each of us individually what it is that we have to contribute, to give, to serve with, to encourage, to gather others to join us in this process. I pray that you would show us uniquely each part that we play. The body is made up of many parts, and yet the body is one. And so as a church, we have many parts, we have many gifts and abilities, and we would love to see each gift serving one another so that the church can maximize its unity and its witness into our society that's watching us and observing how we live, what we say, and evaluating it against what we do. Father, I pray that this morning would be a time where you open our hearts and our minds to the truth in your word, and it allows us to move forward. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. You think about one another, the people that you care for, right? When something happens, you're beginning to think about the people that you care for. And so I'm watching the weather. I'm a weather geek. That's what I am. Any other self-attesting weather geeks? Come on, Joanna. Raise your hand. All right, Joanna, Mary. All right, we got some other weather geeks here. And so I'm watching Hurricane Henry. I called it Henry until I realized I was pronouncing it wrong. What is it? Henri, it's the French pronunciation of Henry, right? Henri, and so I'm watching it, and I'm seeing where the storm track's going, and I pull out my phone, and I'm texting my buddy in Connecticut. And I'm like, hey, how's it going? What are you doing? And he's like, yep, we're prepping, we're getting ready. I said, let me know what happens, and you know what? If you need me to come up with a chainsaw, I'll be there. So anybody want to go with me with a chainsaw? Any takers on that, right? We're going to go up and clear trees. And so I'm praying for my buddy Seth, who's in Connecticut. And then I'm also thinking about there's two other churches in our church family, right? They're connected with us in our Charis Fellowship, and they're on either side of Boston. And so I'm texting the pastors up there, people that I'm friends with. I'm like, Jack, praying for you, praying for your church. Phil, praying for you, praying for your church. Why does my heart go out to them? Because they're part of us, right? And when your family is connected and you're looking at this and you're like, man, pray for so-and-so and pray for, because your heart is connected to them. And so it's like, man, there's a storm heading your way. I'm praying for you guys. Let me know if you need anything, because that's what you do. You care for each other. Now, globally, in a global perspective, right now our hearts as believers, as Christians, are breaking for the church in Afghanistan. Our hearts are breaking as we watch the news of the overthrowing of the Afghanistan government, the Taliban sweeping in, and the persecution of Christians that's going to begin, that's already started, and is going to continue to push as they want to eradicate the church from their culture. And so you hear about these stories, and it's like, what do I do? My heart's breaking because these are people I've never met. I don't have their cell phone number. I don't know their name, but they are believers in Jesus Christ that I care for and that I'm concerned for, and I see these stories, and I say, what can I do? Because I care about them, and I want to pray for them. And at this point, unless we can physically meet needs, prayer is the best way to reach, to support, and to say, God, I'm praying for my believers, my brothers and sisters in Afghanistan who are living in a different country but are serving the same king as I, right? Serving God, the maker of the universe. And so they're my brothers and sisters. We care for one another. Whether it's a hurricane or whether it's an overthrow of government or whether it's an attack or a push, there's cultural challenges coming against the church. And as a church, we look at it and say, how do we navigate this? What do we do? Well, the number one thing is we need to care for each other and we need to do life together. Now, this isn't from the Bible. It's an African proverb, but it says, if you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. You tracking with that? If you want to go fast, go alone. Moms with diaper bags. Anybody? Anybody? You're like, I don't want to take the kids to the grocery store. I want to go fast. I just have to run in and grab 14 gallons of milk and 3 packs of diapers, and right, I just got to run in, run out. Can you keep the kids, right? Moms, you get that, right? You want to go fast, you go alone. But if you want to go far, you go together. We're going to unpack that this morning. It's an African proverb, but I think it draws upon the truth that comes out of God's word. Now, here's the first point we're going to make. It says, if you're a Christian, you need other believers. If you are a Christian, a Christ follower, someone who has put your faith in Jesus Christ, has confessed your sin and confessed with your mouth, believe in your heart, those are the two things needed for someone to get eternal life. If you've done those things, you need other believers. It's not about a solo faith. It's not about doing my thing with God. It's about needing other believers, needing other people. And here's how the Bible kind of addresses it this way. There's 20 people on the screen behind me, right? Those 20 people have put their individual commitment in Christ. Those 20 people said, I need God. I've confessed my sin to God. I believe Jesus Christ is the Son of God. I believe God raised him from the dead 3 days later. And I've confessed my sin. I put my faith in. I've surrendered my life. Now, I'll say that word again. Surrender. We as Americans, we don't like to surrender. We are fiercely independent, right? We want to fight for our freedoms and our rights and our privileges. And yet the Bible calls us to surrender to God all of my life. And so when you put your faith in Jesus and you say, God, you're God, I'm not God. I'm going to surrender my life to do things your way rather than do things my way. I've been doing them my way for a while and it hurts. It's not too pleasant. I make a mess of things, right? I'm an imperfect person. But you put your faith in Jesus and you become an imperfect person being changed by God. So there's those 20 people. They're putting their individual commitment to Christ. God's opened their eyes, opened their heart, drawn them to himself, revealed himself to people. And they say, man, I know that God exists, and I believe that Jesus was his son, and I put my faith in God, and I'm going to obey this book because it is truth, and that's how I'm going to live. So it takes an individual commitment for you to put your faith in Jesus. Your mom can't put your faith in Jesus, right? Your dad can't put your faith. Your grandma can't put your faith in Jesus, right? It doesn't matter what family you've come from. It doesn't matter who your parents are. It doesn't matter. Your pastor can't put your faith in Jesus. Only you can do that. So that's an individual decision, and it's a wonderful decision when somebody puts their faith in Jesus to surrender their lives to do things God's way. Say, God, I'm going to obey you. I'm going to follow you. And so when we look up and we put our faith in Jesus, God has some things to tell us about how we should live with each other. So when we look up and we put our faith in Jesus, we realize that God has some teaching and direction about how to live here on earth. Matthew 28, 19 and 20 says, go and make disciples of all people, all ethnicities, of all languages, right? Go and make disciples of all the world, teaching them to obey all that I've commanded and baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And lo, I'm with you always, very to the end of the age. And so here's the promise that God's saying, go and make disciples. Part of that is teaching them how to live. Specifically on the screen behind me, it says, teaching them to obey all I have commanded. And so we put our faith in Jesus, we're choosing to obey all that God's commanded. And those obedience things, those to-do things, the commands of God, right, they come down from God to us, and they say, okay, look to your left, look to your right. You need each other. Look to your left, look to your right. You have to serve each other. You have to pray for each other. You have to encourage each other. You have to walk beside each other. Look to your left, look to your right. That's the church, and church, I have a job for you to do. And you're not doing it because I, the pastor, am telling you. It's because you have put your faith in Jesus, and God's word has given us commands as to how we should live, and we're committed to Jesus, therefore we're committed to each other. We're committed to Jesus, and we're committed to each other. This is coming from the book of John. If you can read the screen behind me, Jesus was praying. He's just about to head to the cross, and his disciples were listening, and he was praying out loud. Now you think, well, wasn't Jesus and God one? Yes, the answer is yes. So if they're one, how do they talk to each other? Would anyone like to answer that? They're one, yes. But Jesus prayed to God? Yes. So why did Jesus have to tell God? Okay, here's my best answer. Here's my best answer. I think Jesus was talking to God verbally out loud so his disciples could eavesdrop. Are you with me? I think Jesus was talking out loud to his Father in heaven. He probably didn't have to talk out loud for God to hear him because they are one. But I think he wanted his disciples to hear what he was praying about. right? He wanted them to listen in on his conversation with God the Father so that they would know what he was praying about. Here it is, John chapter 17. It says, "My prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message." Jesus is praying also for those who will believe. What tense is that? Any English grammar nuts? Will believe. Future tense. I'm not praying just for these people listening to me, my disciples in front of me. I am praying for those who will believe in this message, right? And so he's praying for the future church. Raise your hand if you are the future church. All right, we got some people, right? We are the, Jesus is praying for us. Jesus is praying for us. We're listening in, right? Now, John was a disciple, and he's writing out what Jesus said. That's how we got the book of John. He's writing out what Jesus said, and he's writing this prayer, and we're reading it because Jesus was praying for us. Verse 21 says, "I'm praying for those who believe in the message, that all of them may be," what? "One. Father, just as you and I, or just as you are in me and I am in you, may they also be in us so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I in them and you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me." This prayer is Jesus praying for the future believers who are going to put their faith, their vertical faith in Jesus, and Jesus is praying that they would then have a horizontal relationship with others, and that relationship would be defined by the word unity. I'm asking for my church to be one. I'm asking for my church to share together life, right? We share our lives together. That we're going to share our eternal life together in heaven when we leave these bodies here on earth, our physical bodies, we get our spiritual bodies, and we get to spend eternity. We're going to spend eternity with all the other believers. Now, some people are sitting here and it's like, am I going to be stuck in heaven with that guy? If he's a believer, yes, right? We need to get along with each other here on earth because we're going to be getting along with each other in heaven for eternity. That's forever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever. And ever, and oh, okay, I'll stop there, right? But we're going to be getting, so we're sharing life together here on earth. We're going to share life together in heaven. We're sharing our faith, right? We all have a common faith that Jesus Christ died on the cross for my sin. He shed his blood on the cross for my sin, for your sin, for the sin of the world. His body was broken on that cross to make payment, to make restitution, to make right our relationship with God. We share that faith. If we're brothers and sisters in Christ, we share that faith. We have a shared love. We love God. We all love the same Heavenly Father. We all worship the same Heavenly Father. That's a piece of the unity. We should have the same purpose. What are you living on earth for? What's your purpose on the planet? Why are you sucking air right now? Why is your heart breathing right now? What is it that you're saying, this is my purpose on life on earth, and I've found my purpose? That purpose is Jesus, to glorify him. That draws a oneness of the church together. It's a shared life, shared eternal life, shared faith, shared love, shared purpose, right? We share truth. That's this book. We don't change the words in this book. This book was given to us. It's the inspired word of God. It came from the breath of God. And so this book is truth in how we live and what we do. It's truth in which we stand upon. So we're all sharing faith and we're sharing the truth in this book. These are components that tie the unity of the church together. It ties the unity of the church together. Now, here's a statement. I want you to think about it. One cannot see the church unless one can see the unity that ties all believers together with the Holy Spirit. It's our unity that lets the church stand out against a world that only knows disunity. It's our togetherness that makes it stand out from a world of separation and individuality. It's our commitment to serve one another that stands out against an outline of people that only know how to serve themselves and to customize and itemize what their own life is about and what they live for and what motivates them. It's our willingness to take one mission forward. It's our willingness to surrender our lives to one truth. That's the Word of God. It's our willingness to come together and to not stop meeting together, as some are in the order of doing, but to continue to gather together, to worship together. We need each other. We need one another. And it's against the backdrop of a world that only knows tension and division that the unity of the church allows it to stand out. It allows it to stand out. Now, we said this a little while ago. Listen, we all drove here in different cars, right? And you might be a fan of your car. And you might drive your car because it is the best car. I'm a fan of a Honda. Any other Honda fans out there? Come on now. Yeah, Honda fans, right? And you're sitting there, you're like, why do you drive a Honda? How do you not realize that Fords are the best car in the world, right? Any Ford fans out there? Like, you drive your Ford. Like, I'm driving a Ford. This is the best car. And it's like, no, I disagree. Let's argue over facts and gas mileage and dependability and repair cost over the spread of the lifetime of the car. Like, we can debate. There are blogs set up where people do that on the internet, right? There are blogs set up to that. And it's like, it can cause division within the church. Let's fight about what car we drive. The reality is, no, let's not fight about it. That's my choice. That's your choice. We're committed to a higher calling than which car we drive. We're committed to a higher calling, right? And so the church takes shots, attacks on our unity. They test our commitment to God. Jesus' prayer is that the church would be one, brought together, not because we agree about what kind of car we drive, brought together because we agree about who God is, who Jesus is, what this Bible says, brought together because we have put our faith and our trust and our hope in Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. And so the church takes shots and attacks, and we say, well, unless we agree about what? About sports teams. We all have to cheer for the same sport. No, it won't have to cheer for the same sports team, right? Unless we all agree about what? About political opinions. Goodness gracious, we probably have everybody in this room has a different political opinion. We couldn't agree, right? We all have different. However, we say our political opinions are not what unify us. It's our commitment as to who Jesus is. And in a world of disagreement and disunity, the church stands out against that backdrop. Because how in the world can people who are so diverse, coming from every tribe, every tongue, every language, every nation, across the globe, how can so many people be committed to the same cause and same mission? That's a supernatural evidence that the church is the church. We're facing storms and stress and decisions, and right now the church is in a spot we haven't been in. I've never pastored through a pandemic, have you? I've never parented through a pandemic, have you? I've never had to navigate a place where so many people have so many different decisions or ideas, and they know everything. And because they know everything, their idea is the best idea, and they have to convince you that their idea is the best idea, therefore you have to listen to their idea. Those are all challenges that test the unity of the church. So how can we as a church stand out with a unity that's committed to God no matter what things come against us? We say, you know what? We're committed to the same call. We're committed to the same cause. We're committed to the same person. These small little things down here about what kind of car I drive, right, or my opinions and my things, like those things are where I have to recognize I'll lay that down for the greater cause. I'll live my convictions. I will preach the truth, though. I'm preaching the truth. My convictions, I'm not going to preach because it's not my job to preach my convictions. It's my job to preach the truth. And the truth unifies. And the truth draws together. And so as a church, if we're loving one another, if we're serving one another, if we're living life the way God calls us to live, then there will be something that comes out of the church that the world looks at and says, where did that come from? Where did that unity come from? Where did that compassion come from? Where did that love come from? Where did the one anothering come from? Because in the world, they don't ever see that. It's not replicated where people are individualistic. It's where faith comes together and the faith creates a oneness. Our faith in God, therefore, causes us to love one another equally and together. So we're in the book of Acts, and we're going to take a peek here, so we're going to spend some time in the book of Acts, chapter 2, verses 42 to 47, and I just want to set it up this way. Acts is a history book, right? So you have to understand what the book was written to express, the genre of the culture, the genre of the language and the writing. This is a history book. It's being written by a medical doctor, a trained medical doctor. His name was Luke, and he's just recording the history of who went where, what they did, who made decisions, and how the church grew. It's just recording the growth of the early church. Jesus is taken up into heaven, And there's 120 believers in the upper room when Jesus left. 3.5 years of ministry, and how many people are committed to Jesus? 120. 120 people in the upper room after 3.5 years of talking to thousands of people and doing miracles and feedings and all that kind of stuff, right? So Jesus has 120 people in the upper room, and the book of Acts is the story of how those 120 people went on to reshape the entire civilization, right? That's where the Christian church comes from. That's where the faith comes from. It's those 120 people. So the book of Acts is recording this. And it's kind of, you know, I think of this passage in Acts chapter 2, verse 42 to 47. I think of it kind of as a Polaroid picture. Anybody have Polaroid cameras, right? You get a picture of the church, and then you shake it for a while, and then what comes out? The picture, right? This is amazing. I mean, kids today, they'll be amazed by that. Pull out your Polaroid and take a picture and give it to them. They understand how their cell phones work. They won't understand how Polaroid works. But here it is. It's almost like this vintage picture of what the early church looked like. We get to peek in to see what they were doing. We get to see what unity looked like. We get to say, what should churches do? What does the Bible say churches should do, right? And so we get to see that actually happen here in Acts chapter 2. Here's what it says. They devoted themselves, they, talking about, it's pronoun, plural, right? They, the people who have put their faith in Jesus. People who have put their faith in Jesus. If you have never put your faith in Jesus, you're not a part of the church. That's the first step to get to be a part of the church. You have to put your individual faith in Jesus, and then in turn, you surrender your life and you do what God calls you to do. You live the way God calls you to live. They, people who had put their faith in Jesus, devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship and to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wondrous signs performed by the apostles. Verse 44 says, and all the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. So it's a snapshot of what community looked like. It's a snapshot of what spiritual formation looked like. It's a snapshot of what it looked like to worship and to be a part of the early church. Here's the list that I see in my Polaroid picture. As it develops, I see people being devoted to the apostles' teaching. People were being taught. Someone that understood something was explaining that to someone who didn't understand it. You can't teach yourself. You can't be devoted to your own teaching. Right? They were devoted to other people's teaching. You can't do that alone. It takes someone to help teach you what you don't understand, to help explain to you what you don't know. They were in fellowship. Well, what does that word mean? If you break it down, it means spiritual togetherness. Spiritual togetherness. They were with other people who believed the same things they believed. They were with other people who had the same spiritual beliefs as they did. Another word for fellowship is partnership. I'm at a church, I'm at a place where I'm a partner with the other people. We're all on the same team. We're all working for the same cause. There was devotion to teaching, and there's fellowship. You need other people to have fellowship. There is breaking of bread. Now, biblically, that word points to communion, where you take the bread, and Jesus said, this is my body, which is broken for you, and that's what we do when we do communion. They were gathering together. You can't do communion by yourself. You have to do communion with other people. There was corporate prayer. They were praying together. You can have individual prayer, but you have to have other people to pray with if you're going to have corporate prayer. If you're going to fulfill and do what we're seeing here, you have to have other people praying with you. There were miracles and signs. God was answering prayers, and he was doing amazing things. And again, it's other people. God was working in other people's lives, and you got to see it and then go tell people. Let me tell you what God did in my friend's life. Let me tell you about a healing that God did. Let me tell you about how he answered prayer. There's giving and generosity. That involves other people. If you're going to be a generous person, you have to be giving to who? Others. You can't be a generous and a selfish person at the same time, right? I only give to myself. Yeah, it's called selfishness. If we're going to be generous, we have to have other people that we're giving to. They were meeting together, right? You can't be alone and meet together. Right? The church was committed to each other. They were committed to meeting together. You need other people to meet together. They were eating together, right? Sign me up for that one. Anybody else? Sign it up. I want to eat together. This is good. Like, there's something about sharing a meal that's special. The church, you have to eat with other people. Don't eat alone. Eat with other people. There was corporate worship. They gathered together to worship. That means other people were in the room. You can't have corporate worship by yourself. And people were getting saved. And I asked the why. Why were people getting saved? Because the unity of the church, the togetherness of the church, the fellowship of the church, the commonality of the church, the love of the church, the service of the saints, the prayers of the people, they were all seeing people live out what Jesus taught. And it stood out against the backdrop of society so much they said, you know what? I see what the world offers. I see what Jesus offers. I want what Jesus offers. The church is the billboard. The unity of the church is what's displaying what the gospel message should really look like. It's not the division of the church. It's not the fighting of the church. It's not the political, you know, jockeying of the church. It's about our commitment and our call to Jesus and to the gospel, period. Let's not mix in all the divisive stuff. Let's not argue about what kind of car is better. Let's not bring our own political agendas in. Let's not bring our own convictions that might be different than somebody else's conviction. Let's stick to the truth, and this is what the truth looks like. You want another, each other. You have to, because God tells us to. We can't keep God's commands if we're not one anothering each other and loving each other and serving each other. Worship team's going to come up as we prepare for our closing song, and I just want to bounce to this quote that I had given you earlier. We can advance the slide to the last slide, that'd be great. But it says, remember the African proverb? It said to go further together, right? You want to go fast, you go alone. If you want to go further, you go together. Now, biblically, here's what I see the Bible saying, right? Biblically, here's what I see the Bible saying. We go further together because that's the way God designed the church. We go further together because that's the way God designed the church. I need you. You need me. If I don't serve you, if you don't serve me, the church won't be the church. If we don't gather to pray together, to worship together, to fellowship together, to break bread together, to serve the community together, to be actively following what Jesus says together, if we're not coming together to do this, division is keeping us apart. And the church is not being the church Jesus prayed for. Father, make them one as you and I are one. Let the world know that they are mine because of how much they are united in purpose. And a mission. The church was designed to need each other. Yes, we're a needy church. We need each other. We need one another. We serve one another. We value others above ourselves. And in doing this, we're actually being the church that God called us to be. If you're a Lone Ranger Christian, you're all by yourself, you don't need other people, you don't care for other people, you don't talk to other people, you're missing out the power of team that God has called the church to have. Man, what can the church do when we're together? We can do anything. What can we go through? We can go through anything. How can we further the mission? It doesn't matter. We can do it together because we're called and committed to that same message. The worship team is going to lead us in one closing song. Through it all, my eyes.
Through it all, my
couple of dates to put on your calendar before we kick you out of here. The first of which is Randy Smith is coming, and that's going to be the 12th, 13th, and 14th at 6:30 p.m. in those evenings. That'll be a Sunday, Monday, Tuesday. If you don't know who Randy Smith is, if you do know, you're going to be here for it. He is a scholar. He's an archaeologist. He's very up on what's going on in culture today and how it ties in with what Scripture says. So if you're at all interested in that kind of thing, this is something you want to be at. And if you know who Randy Smith is, he's very engaging as a speaker, very energetic, and it's worthwhile to listen to what he has to say. So that's coming up. Mark your calendars for that. Also, we have Bible Adventures starting here in the next couple of weeks. Our first meeting for that is going to be this Tuesday. If you are available during the week and would love to help out with Bible Adventure, where we walk the kids down from Ferguson Elementary and spend an hour teaching them about God's Word through the school day, if that's at all interesting to you, see me, see Pastor Dustin, see Jenny or Eva. We would love to get you information about how you can get hooked up with that. The last thing and most exciting thing is on September 5th is our Rebrand Sunday. So you see that that is 14 days away from today. We're excited about that and what it means. We are going to have a Welcome to Thrive Church party. We're going to do things that this church has never done before on that day. And so really invite people to come to it. It's an exciting time. We're going to talk about what it means to be part of Thrive Church moving forward from that day. So we're glad that you guys are part of the church. We look forward to what we're doing together, and we'll see you guys next week.